Hi there, and welcome to Footyology, the show which, unlike our political system, gives you a decisive verdict every time. I'm Rohan Connolly, with me is my co-host Mark Fine, and we're here to give you the lowdown on a big round 15, the games that were gripping, and one so goddamn awful it made Anthony Green's election pendulum seem like the 1970 grand final in comparison. We're going to catch up with one of football's leading player managers for his take on some controversial issues confronting the game. We'll have the hots and nots out of the weekend, your old favourite rounds of our lives, keyball Q&A, and of course the rant-off. In fact, we might throw in Andrew Bolt's tantrum from election night and make the rant-off a three-way contest before doing a preference deal and telling him to piss right off. So let's start the count as I say good afternoon to you, Finey. Well, the major parties can't get a majority. Is it now, in fact, the AFL in best position to form a government?
Yeah, possibly. The AFL, don't they run Australia anyhow?
Oh, well, they might as well.
Certainly the Australia that I live in. But the election was great. I voted. I don't know whether my boys got in the Senate. I hope they do.
Your boys?
Sex party, pirate party.
I think the pirate party actually did okay. What was their policy platform?
More lime and lemons for sailors, so less rickets.
And a bottle of rum.
Oh, har.
As you might have gathered, we'll have more than our share of election analogies today. Let's get straight into it. We've finished the bye rounds with a final lot of six games, a couple of beltings and a real blinder among them. Let's talk about the best and the rest in Hot or Not. Okay, you're up first today.
I'm going to go with... I'll start with a not, and it's pretty obvious. It's St Kilda and their inability to travel interstate. And it's got... The problem is it's getting worse. They travel like a transplanted lung in an esky without ice. They just cannot seem to create the same pressure they do at Etihad. It is a bit of a mental thing. What St Kilda need to do to win games interstate is have the ball. There's different phases. We've got it, they've got it, and contested ball. And there's so little contested ball when St Kilda play. There was less than 80 total tackles in that game. When they play interstate, they've got to make the ground smaller. There's a technique to do it, they don't know it.
I saw the numbers on that. They average 72 tackles a game. They recorded 45 against the Suns. So, yep, spot on, not good enough. Okay, a hot for me to start with, and it's Clay Smith of the Western Bulldogs. Sort of got lost a bit in the win because it was such a great win, but three knee reconstructions, finally made it back. And it wasn't just a token appearance, Finney. He was terrific. He had 16 possessions, six tackles, two direct goal assists, one a pass to Tom Liberatore in that big period in the third quarter. And the other one, if you have a look at the replay back, a great extraction from a real cluster of bodies, got the ball out, and I think Lockie Hunter capitalised on that. More midfield numbers for them, real tough, contested player. He's going to be a really valuable part of their finals assault.
I just was shocked when he got picked.
Why?
I thought that he was a long way off playing still.
No, I think he'd had three or four back. So yeah. Anyway, great effort.
I've got to say, I look at the best in the VFL. When you see the name Smith, I just didn't think Clay Smith.
You thought Rohan Smith?
I thought another Smith. Okay. But I'd forgotten about him. Bit of a forgotten man in footy. And another forgotten man in football is my hot, and that's Tom Cloury of Port Adelaide.
Oh, yeah.
I'd almost forgotten about him. I mean, Tom Cloury got a game. There was a late withdrawal. Homsch was who's the defender they've got? Homsch?
Yep.
He was supposed to play...
Late withdrawal.
When I saw Tom Cloury being picked, I must say that I thought he'd been delisted. And he had a red-hot go. It was though he said, if I come here and just spoil... Yeah, Homsch couldn't do that. I'll be replaced. So when he got the ball, he dashed. And you know what? On a wet night, he actually, in a wet game, he actually looked like a really good running defender. Might have some more footy for Tom Cloury now.
Yeah, I thought he was all right. They've turned up a couple, Burn Jones and another one who's come through this year. So a bit of light amidst a pretty ordinary season for him.
And that, you know, that's a hot. His tackle on Deledio in the second quarter, that just lifted the whole team because he had a first go at him and missed it. Then he got him, got the free kick, and everybody said, if Burn Jones is doing it, then surely, given he's the youngest player in the team, we should as well. I think he lifted the whole side.
Okay, my second one is sort of a combined hot or not. Now, the half hot bit is the final series we're headed for. It's just amazing at the moment. One team on top of the ladder, but now five teams equal on 10 wins. It's going to be that contest for spots in the eight, and of course the top four being pivotal that's just going to be huge over the last eight rounds of the season. Unfortunately, that leads me to my not, which is I think we could have more than usual numbers of ordinary games. Now, I did a bit of a stock take. There's 72 games left. There's only nine being played between top eight opponents, so we'll obviously be focusing on them. Unfortunately, there's 19 of those 72 games that are going to be played by sides essentially out of contention for the top eight. So I'm really hoping the Carlton-Collingwood game Saturday night isn't a guide to what we're going to see over the remaining couple of months, because we could be snoring our heads off by the time we get to September.
The one probably saving grace is Gold Coast actually were really good on the weekend.
Yeah.
If you're playing them at Metricon and you're in the top eight, watch out, Banana Pete.
Yeah, the traditional spoiler role. Someone's got to do it. Okay.
Melbourne remain interesting. St Kilda at Etihad. There are a few teams outside the eight that present a bit of a challenge. My final not hot is the 2015 trade period and what it turned up for certain clubs. What a bust for some teams. Yarran to Richmond, bump bow. Bennell to Fremantle, bump bow. Carlisle and Freeman to St Kilda, no games whatsoever.
Was another Richmond one, Townsend.
A couple of games. Redden and Adcock, you would have thought, would have added a little bit to West Coast and the Western Bulldogs. The Western Bulldogs have been able to integrate players that you barely knew existed, like Biggs, into their side. No good. A lot of them have been busts. Of course, we've got the two beauties in Treloar and Dangerfield, but aside from them, not a good trade period.
There's actually a conspiracy about Jed Adcock. I've done a deal with the Bulldogs. He will not be selected until people adopt the nickname for him, the extension. Been trying to get it going for years, just hasn't happened. We need more action on the nickname front for Jed.
And also, those people that want him in the team, just yelling out his surname is confusing.
It is. Okay, final one for me quickly, and it's a hot, and it's Adelaide. Wasn't one of their best wins of a season against Melbourne, but the Demons really came to play, and it's the sort of game that Crows, I reckon, in the last couple of years probably would have lost. They've been good at sort of shooting themselves in the foot, but they really rallied. Great third quarter in response to what Melbourne did in the second quarter, and then the last quarter was really tough, and they held Melbourne at bay when the Demons came at them hard. I think the first goal wasn't kicked for about 12 minutes. They recorded over 100 tackles, so they've got that defensive pressure you're looking for. I think their defence is underrated. I think the midfield is pretty handy, and the Crouch brothers bobbed up again too, so that was significant. I think it gives them midfield depth, and their forward setup is the best in the competition. So they're very close to a top four spot, and if they get it, look out. I reckon there's every chance they could actually win the flag.
You bet. I mean, they've got that beautiful structure, but to quote the robot from Lost in Space, warning, do not lose Sam Jacobs.
No, true. But he's not the only ruckman who a team had paid dearly for losing.
No, but Adelaide's the only team that do not have a backup ruckman. Luke Loudon's played one game in 8 years.
True, 8 years. Time for a short break. When we come back, our news hound's here to sort through the spin, cut through the crap, and untangle the untruths. But first, let's go to the post-game press conferences with our roving reporter, Grant Dickinson. He's been busy again this week, keeping the coaches accountable, and sometimes leaving not just them, but us bemused with the pressing questions.
You put Caitlin Jenner in the ruck in the first quarter. Do you think she plays better as a man or a woman?
I'm not making comparisons to... in terms of what he used to be. It's what he is now. That's all I'm interested in. And fundamentally, he's just being judged on effort. And I thought he gave that today.
Welcome back to Footyology. And there's no rest for John Pierik when footy season's on. He didn't even have time to vote last Saturday. He was so busy rifling through the ballot boxes, just hoping to find a stray player contract in with all the voting slips. That's the sort of dedication that produces the big stories and the odd libel suit. But hopefully it'll be just the former when he delivers tomorrow's news today. What's going on, JP?
Is it too late to get that vote in, Ron?
Yeah, I think the fine's in the mail. Do you live in Chisholm?
Yes.
You are in Chisholm.
Yeah, I am Chisholm, yep.
Well, last time I checked, there was about 60 votes of difference. So see if you can get down there and do the right thing.
Yeah, I'll keep that in mind.
All right, what's going on?
Well, I guess the growing issue among coaches at the moment is in terms of the round 23 bye and how it's going to affect teams come September. It was brought in, as we know, because of North Melbourne resting players in round 23 last year. This brought it on into question some integrity issues. Coaches now are concerned that it's going to give the teams in the bottom four perhaps an unfair advantage, having the week off. Sometimes they limp into the eight. This is a way of freshening them up. But also for the teams in the top four, if you win the qualifying final now, you may only have the one game in 3 weeks because you'll have the bye, qualifying final, then another week off. So it could certainly disrupt premiership aspirations.
Well, two things on this. I guess the scenario you've thrown up reminds me a bit of Finey of 1990 when Essendon finished on top, rested players in the last round, then Collingwood and West Coast drew in the qualifying final.
They didn't just rest players in the last round with a great deal of...
four Danahers.
Hubris and arrogance. They came to Moorabbin and decided to display all Danahers on the one afternoon in an exhibition game of football and were therefore punished when Collingwood drew. So.
Okay, I believe they still won that game, however. As I was saying, replay Collingwood West Coast. And I think Essendon, some Essendon players ended up playing literally one game in a month. So, but the obvious question here is, why weren't these concerns raised when the fixture was released?
Well, I don't think they were. It's all of a sudden just dawned upon these teams the advantages. It's a bit like several things in the AFL system.
Because they are spurious arguments. Yeah. So let me see. For most of football's history, as we know it, there was a top four. You won week one. Sorry, the top five. With the top five. If you finished on top, you had the first week off. Then you won the next week, then you had another week off. And then you went and won a grand final. Where's the problem?
Well, you know what it's like, Finey. It's footy. You just rinse and repeat the controversies from 20, 30 years ago. We do it all the time.
Well, Ross Lyon and Chris Scott have voiced their concerns about this.
Ross Lyon has. Well, that's interesting. He's coaching about it. It's about 23rd on the ladder. Good one, Ross.
Anyway, we'll move on from that one. The Doggies have a big call to make this week in terms of Tom Boyd. He was suspended last week because of his altercation with his teammate Zane Cordy, a bit of a boozy night out after their bell game. He was suspended indefinitely. It was an issue that happened about a month ago. It was kept on the quiet. That was another issue in terms of how the Doggies have handled this, where they've attracted a fair bit of criticism. Kicked four goals, though, in the VFL at the weekend. Finally, has the time come for the Dogs to work out whether Boyd is in their best 22 heading into the finals?
I think he is in their best 22. Again, Redpath on the weekend, not a hugely influential game. Kicked the single goal. Boyd is important to that team. They reacted to what they felt would be perceived public perception, which is what every club does now. An indefinite ban. Sensibly, he played on the weekend in the VFL. I would be shocked if he was not available for selection this week. Enough's enough. You know, the tail is wagging the dog in many of these cases, and the tail is the shrill voices of splinter interest groups in the public that have good causes but are constantly sabotaging and hijacking football issues for their own purposes.
I think you're sort of pointing the finger at the wrong target there. I thought the club handled it really, really badly.
They did, but I don't want to get stuck in them because every club does the same now. They are so concerned about PC, about not being seen to be stepping on the toes.
Yeah, but stick by your guns. I mean, if the thing isn't that big a deal, don't suspend and fine him.
Which club would stick by their guns? Which club would thumb their nose at the perceived link between what happened with them and one punch violence?
Hope most clubs would be able to put out a press release in English rather than refer to this incident as happening in the last recent weeks. Mm. So the whole thing was a pretty ordinary sort of PR performance from the Bulldogs, I think. Apparently, they're a bit dirty on me about a few things I said, but it made...
Well, they should be. You're getting stuck into them for the quality of the press release.
But it made Luke Beveridge look silly because he came out and spoke about Tom Boyd as if he was playing when they knew he wasn't. They made their own coach look silly. Yeah. So don't point the finger at the media guys for... saying you've made your own coach look silly. You did it,
comes
not
from
us.
The football department, yeah.
It's true, but we live in an environment where every public statement made by organisations is in fear of being perceived as pro-violence, pro-violence towards women, etc., over and over again. How you can make a connection between two mates having a scuffle and one punch violence and then be scared of the aftermath is...
It speaks so much to
2016.
Well, the Dogs have told Footyology it'll be a club decision and not just the leadership group, which will determine whether he comes back.
They actually told me because they're not talking to him.
Told us to. There's a fair bit going on at Punt Road, obviously. About 20 players are out of contract this season. Ty Vickery is one of them. He's been mentioned before on Footyology. Doesn't seem like there's too much interest in him at the moment. Some rock player agents believe his currency's on the wane because of his poor form, in particular recently. He's only averaging about 8 touches a game, not really kicking any goals. Chris Yaron's back on light duties at the Tigers. The Tigers say they're hopeful he can play one game this season just to make him feel like he really belongs at the club, but they won't push him because of his physical and mental issues that he's been dealing with, but they're glad he's just back at the club at the moment. And the Blues are set to announce a deal, a partnership with Siemens Wireless Ultrasound Technology. It's going to help them have a look at injuries during the game in terms of examining bleeding in the joints and the like before even a physical examination by the club doctors. So it's just another way the Blues are trying to become elite on and off the field as part of their rebuild under Brendan Bolton.
Interesting stuff on Richmond players. Just, I think basically time's up for Ty. I mean, they've shown a lot of patience with him. He hasn't delivered. They've got to start looking elsewhere. And, you know, the obvious connection will be made with Michael Hurley. They'd be silly not to have a fairly sizeable crack at him, I reckon.
And looks like Kane Lambert will get a new deal, so he looks like being one of the safer players there at this stage.
Okay, all right, just quickly on Richmond.
You've always got to just, tight for time here, hurry up.
Include me in the discussion, because I put a challenge to Richmond, and that is, once again, they get naming players that they're interested in post-season, Hurley, Prestia. If they once again don't deliver, there will be absolute mayhem. They'll destroy the place. They'll tear the place down, their fans. Don't promise or suggest players and don't get them.
Well, their recruiting's going to be under the microscope as well, so that I wouldn't be surprised if there's a couple of changes there.
OK. Good work. Hang around this week. We've got a very special guest, and we want you, JP, to be part of the interview.
Look forward to it.
A quick break now. When we return, our special guest is a man at the forefront of player issues in the game for the past 30 years. See you in a minute.
Pretty lacklustre effort after the game, singing a theme song and throwing drinks around. Who could you bring in to improve that?
We hope Tom will come back shortly and really offer us something up there. And
Look, he's snuggled up to me on the couch. Great stuff. Thanks, JP. Our guest today has been looking after the affairs of leading AFL players for a long time. He's pivotal to negotiations for the players' cut of what has become a huge revenue pool for the game. He's a leading voice in what is becoming a big debate about the impact of concussion on footballers. And he's a tough negotiator whose name makes club bean counters start trembling. Welcome to the show, Peter Jess.
Thank you, Ro.
Very immaculately dressed. I didn't know our show had so much cred.
Well, it does. I'm here just to show it off for you, mate.
All right. Well, for people that perhaps aren't as familiar with your work, it's been a long, long time, and I know you've got some great stories, but just tell us about how you initially got involved. Your cousin, of course, was the great Jim Jess,
yep.
Richmond centre-half forward, and I believe you were of the belief that they were sort of paying him a pittance, and you're in a position to do something about it.
Well, Jim was the first client that I worked for and was by default. Jim came and asked me, he said, well, this is what I'm getting paid. What do you think? Prior to that, his dad had done it, and his dad had signed him up for 10 grand a year. And so I looked at it. I looked at the currency of the players that were round, and John Petura sprung to mind, and John was getting paid 120 grand. And so I said to Jim, well, look, what we'll do is we'll walk in there and we'll say that we want $100,000 a year. But before we do that, we need to go and talk to a few clubs to make sure that if they do pull the trigger, we've got somewhere to go. So I went and spoke to Collo. And
at Carlton, Ian Collins.
Yeah, Ian Collins. And so I got Collo to sign up a letter to say that if Jimmy came to Carlton through whatever means, then he'd be paid X dollars, which is a little bit more than what he got paid at the Tigers. But so Jim was happy with that. We went down and met the club. There was GR, Graham, Richmond, Kevin Dixon, Octa Wilson, and Kit Carson, the used car salesman. And they're all sitting around. And so Jim and I walked in, and GR led off and said, well, Jimmy, what do you want? And before Jimmy could open his mouth, I said, 100,000. And GR sort of looked at me, and Octa Wilson was about to jump over the desk and strangle me. And so we had a bit of a laugh. And anyway, they said, well, no, let's talk serious. What do you really want? And I said, 100. And they said, Jimmy, is this what you want? And Jimmy's nodded. Didn't say much. He just nodded. Mm, yeah. So GR turned to Jimmy. He said, Jimmy, if you want 100, you can fuck off now. So I said, okay, Jim, let's go. So we stood up. We walked out. There's a bit of a thing. I said, and by the way, I've already spoken to Colo. So anyway, so there was a bit of a huddle, and GR said, okay, all right, come in. So we walked back in, and there's a bit of a discussion. He said, you sure it's 100? I said, yeah, definitely, 100, or else we're up the road. And so, you know, GR's turned to Ghost, and he said, Jimmy, we'll pay you 100 on one condition. And Jimmy said, what's that? He said, GR said, never ever bring this fucking little prick back into this joint ever again. So that was me.
Well, right. I'd just like to apologise to the folks at home for the use of the phrase used car salesman. yeah, we're going to get into some hot topics of the day, but just like off the top of your head, who would be the biggest five players you've managed over the years?
I'd say the best two would be Gary Ablett Sr.
Yeah, not bad.
And Greg Williams.
Yeah, give you that.
Closely followed then by the Madden brothers.
Yeah.
Earl the Pearl.
Earl Sporting.
Yep. Yeah. And a plethora of others.
I was just trying to give people a sense of the sort of names you've been involved with.
Pete, you've been at the forefront of raising awareness about concussion. It's obviously exploded again this week with St Kilda forward Paddy McCartan receiving his third head knock for the season. This is what St Kilda coach Alan Richardson had to say about where Paddy's at the moment.
Yeah, look, it's a bit early, really. It'll be up to the doctors and the medicos. They'll do everything necessary to make sure that he's either right to play or not. I haven't actually had an opportunity to chat to the docs at this stage, but it'll just be up to our medical team.
Pete, are you happy with the state of play with how concussion's being treated at the moment, and do you feel there could be a class action down the track?
Which part do I answer first, John?
Both.
So if I said no and yes, and they're not changeable. So am I satisfied with the concussion regime at the moment in the AFL? It's an emphatic no. It's improved, but we still don't have a rapid point of care diagnostic tool that actually can tell us whether a player is hurt or not and the extent of it. Now, there's been research after research throughout the world now with multimodalities, which include blood tests, which include saliva tests, which includes various types of scans. At this stage, there is no club, there is no benchmark throughout the league that where this is in situ, you know, to give the players the best chance of A, being diagnosed and then being treated and then being put into a rehab, mm-hmm. you know, program. So it's a huge gap. Class action, the second part of your question. I put this proposition to the AFLPA at their last, you know, conference. Would they support it? Brett Murphy said he's not sure under what act that you would sue. Well, I can help him. It's called the Wrongs Act. And it's a difficult process because what it is, it's about duty of breach of care. So what we have to establish that the AFL knew and did nothing about it, and if it did know, what it did know, and what did it put in place to make sure the players were safe.
Are there former players out there keen to pursue this?
Look, there's a number of players that I've spoken to who are less than happy with the current circumstances, because basically what happens is this is it, because the AFL got the Victorian State Government to change the work cover laws in 1972. Professional sportsmen have been excluded from long-term cover under such things as work cover. So effectively what happens when you finish and you're off the list, you're on your own. Mm. You know, like, there's a little bit of support, not great, and it's pretty much as I put it, walking around the ground with a blanket and getting people to feel sorry for you and throw, you know, a few bob in. I mean, it's complete nonsense. I mean, one of the things that I've been pushing for is for the change in, you know, the legislation, get sportsmen back into the workers' compensation where they should be, and then they get long-term care. The same in terms of the funding for the research into concussion. I mean, I've put it to the AFL that they should have a ticket levy system, and I've been doing this for the last 5 or 6 years, and they refuse to fund the research.
So there clearly needs to be more collaboration between yourself and the AFLPA and the AFL. I mean, is there, how much more ground can there be made up before we really sort of get to the realistic possibility of a class action or a strike or anything of that nature?
Well, I've always been very strong on the fact that, you know, we would have to be in dire straits for a strike to happen, because I think it alienates fans. We've seen it in the US, we've seen it everywhere else. From my point of view, it just shouldn't happen. But it is a legitimate tactic. I think there's other things that they can do, such as in terms of gaming and other things. They can say, well, you know, they're not going to have their image used in gaming, which is a big money spinner, and a whole range of other sort of stuff. But in terms of a class action, I would think that the support for that is very strong. The appetite is that, you know, the AFLPA, because it's largely funded by, you know, the AFL, there is a lesser degree for them to want to participate in a direct, you know, knock them down, punch on with City Hall. But I mean, sooner or later, that may change, but I can't see it in the short term.
I've got another fix, Pete, and that is that every footballer, when he commences his career on a yearly basis, pardon me, signs a waiver recognising the inherent dangers of a contact sport and will sign away his right to sue the AFL. Now, that might seem to a player manager and to the AFLPA absolute heresy.
No, it
exists in sport. If you want to go in the rodeo, you sign a waiver because you know riding bulls is bloody dangerous.
Yeah.
I'm telling you that if we get too protective of players following their careers as professional sports people playing football, most people who play footy do so not for money, but at risk of exactly the same dangers. Why, if we continue to go down this track, would anybody play football, allow their children to play football, etc.?
Well, I think you can answer that yourself. You know, I mean,
the game will die. I'm telling you, the game will die if we're worried about protecting players from contact injuries.
No. Look, it's about having the ability to diagnose and to make the game safe.
Yeah. Now, that's fair enough.
Once we have, you know, the architecture to ensure the safety of the players via rapid point of care technology pitch side, you can actually then mitigate a whole range of the outcomes that happen with, you know, concussion. There was research done in Melbourne by a scientist who had developed a system whereby post-match or post, or even during the game, you could take a blood test within 20 minutes. They could tell the extent of the, you know, concussion and what you needed to do in terms of the treatment regime, whether it be get wrapped in an ice vest, slow down the flow of the blood to your head, the whole range of things. And then she had developed this form of antidote, which means that you could mitigate it from, you know, the acute outcomes to actually a mild and nothing. Now, the AFL has steadfastly refused to fund that research, and it's available in Victoria and would be world-leading technology. Why?
Just on another issue, Peter, you look after Nathan Lovett Murray, who's been seeking compensation from Essendon for the 2012 supplements program.
Yep.
Where are things at in terms of the compensation? Do you fear this will drag on into 2017?
Well, sensible people need to come together very quickly. This has dragged on way too long. There hasn't been a process up to now whereby claims can be looked at in a sensible, you know, commercial outcome. I mean, I think the biggest issue is this, that the club hasn't recognised the extent of the damage that they've caused to players. They really haven't got a real good handle on that. I mean, it is quite frightening. I mean, whilst the club now is trying to do the right thing, it really hasn't shown full, you know, contrition to what has actually happened to these players and their families.
What's the total potential exposure for Essendon? How much end game could this cost the Essendon Football Club?
Look, that's a very good question, and I'm surprised it's come from you, Finey, but anyway, we'll press on. I think it's in layers, because there are players who are going back to the club and they will sacrifice the real value of the damages to be part of the club going forward, and it'll probably be rolled up into their next gig. There are other players who have left the club, excuse me, and they will have a different view. And then there are players who have, you know, retired and who have been excluded from getting jobs as coaches. In terms of quantum, I would think, you know, that it would be not out of the realms of somewhere between 30 million plus.
That's good news. I'm an Essendon supporter. We've got to wrap it up there, unfortunately. But just before we go, we did drag up an old clip from the archives. You're not averse to a stoush, and you've had a few over the years. But one of the most entertaining ones I remember was over Nicky Winmar's renegotiation of a contract back in 1993. You appeared on a Sunday footy show, and you had a fair old sparring match with, believe it or not, Ian Molly Meldrum.
Now, how are you or Stephen Dunn going to break an AFL contract that is there for 2 years? How can you assure that player that you'll have him in a November draft? Because believe me, I spoke to Stephen Dunn on Friday night. He said he won't come back to St Kilda and we'll have him in a new club by November. How are you going to do it? Well, are you bigger than the AFL contract? I know you've done some pretty amazing things in life, mate, but are you bigger than the AFL contract?
Well, I don't think that is the issue.
Well, of course it's the damn issue.
Well, if I can have my say.
Well, please.
Thank you.
You're not saying much at the moment.
All right. Well, because you're opening your slapper.
Don't take the piss, mate.
Looking pretty dapper there, Pete. I think I preferred those glasses to those ones, actually.
Yeah, well, look, that was going back a few years, right?
Yeah, well,
I put on a few pounds in the wrong places.
Only the mullet survived.
The mullet survived.
You got the deal sorted in the end?
Sorry?
You obviously got the deal sorted with Winmar in the end.
Yeah, look, I think culturally it just exposed the club and the league to just how far away that they didn't get the whole gamut of what he was talking about. What had happened, they said to him, is that if you perform well during the year and you finish in the top three best and fairest, we will increase your pay to X dollars. Nicky took them at his word, at their word, and then went back in and said, well, you promised me that you would pay me. And there was a collective sigh in the room as if somebody just flattened a tyre, and you could say, well, yeah, we did tell you, but, you know, but you're Nicky Winmar. You don't really expect to get paid that, do you? Mm. And he said, well, you know, via us, we said, well, yeah, really? So you should pay him, or else, you know, obviously he then needs to wonder whether, in fact, you're looking after him in the best way. I mean, you can't promise somebody that you're going to do something and then at the end of the season he's, you know, performed at a very good level, you know, come to him and say, well, yes, we did promise you, but we've changed our mind.
I think it was worth playing that clip just to hear Molly Meldrum speaking articulately without mumbling. Unfortunately, nothing to do with music. Maybe he should have been in the footy media rather than the music media. Great stuff, Pete. Really fascinating chat, and I'm sure we'll be hearing a lot more about several of those topics you covered. Another break now. When we come back, we unlock the vaults of round 15 in seasons gone by. Welcome back, and it's time to turn the back... I'll start again. You threw me again. Welcome back, and it's time to turn back the clock to a simpler, if not gentler, time in the game. A time when you could watch a curtain raiser, yell what you wanted, and when you didn't need to mortgage your house just to buy a soggy hot dog. Round 15's had some big moments. Let's take a look at them now because like Peter Landy calling a wet football a cake of soap ad nauseam, so are the rounds of our lives. Well, it's going to be really interesting this week, Finey, because I've completely forgotten the order I worked out for these clips. So I think we start in 1971, round 15, and the venue is the Junction Oval. Peter McKenna is a Collingwood full forward, but also heartthrob. He's about to kick his second century of goals for the season. Let's have a look at it.
Over at the Junction Oval, Peter McKenna brought up his second successive 100 with this goal against Fitzroy. And then he had to put up with the consequences. McKenna ended the season with 134 goals and a reputation as a singer. His record of things to remember sold 7,000 copies.
Here they come. Here they come. The kids are coming on the ground now. McKenna has kicked his 100th goal.
Yes, he had his much vaunted hit single. What was that single he put out called again?
I always mix it with Lionel Rose's, so I'm not quite sure.
Yeah.
But the sprint out to the player was fantastic when they kicked 100 goals. Did you ever partake in any on-field
shenanigans? Yeah, in fact, I did it at that same ground when Fred Cook kicked his 100th goal in a VFA grand final.
Yeah, I never ran out onto the ground except... I do know a certain St Kilda supporter who ran out for a Tony Lockett 100 goal. On his 99th goal, he jumped the fence. he started early. I don't know whether or not he got fined for it, but he made it about 15 metres on the ground and we were yelling at him, "It's not his 100th." No, it actually was, the shot for the 100th was a point, just to correct myself.
Our next clip... is going to be interesting because I've completely forgotten what it is. How am I going today? It's a Geelong comeback. I'm being guided here. Who's it a Geelong comeback against? I've really got to do these things later in the week, don't I? Let's throw to the action, then we'll talk about it.
Stokes fumbled. They still win it. Duncan, perfect hand pass. Gives Stokes a second chance. Heppel, Chapman with him. Chapman to Pudsey Adley. Little knock on. Oh. Is an unbelievable goal. Cramery, was it clever or not? We'll find out in a moment. He's got it again. He goes for Davey. Duncan in his path. Davey gets out. Collier again. Monfries. Melksham. Bombers. The Bombers have got to be home now. Pats. Duncan into the 50. And Johnson. He's got to have a shot, surely. 33 and a quarter minutes gone. And he knows there are seconds left. Got to kick a goal. Kick two in the last quarter already. It's a mighty roost. He's done it. He's kicked a third.
They need to get it inside 50. Somehow pull off a mark. Is there time?
Ryder got the tap. Ling has a fresh air. Socket by Chapman. Mark by Monfries. It's over. The Bombers have dared to dream tonight. And the dream has turned into a wonderful reality.
I think we're going to rename this segment Dementia of My Life. It wasn't a Geelong comeback. Well, it was a mini comeback, but the story was Essendon. It was 2011, James Hurd's first year as coach. The Cats were king of the heap, and Essendon beat him, not without a sizeable scare, though. And how's that goal from Stevie J flat on his back?
They're easy to forget. It's an understandable mistake.
No, I'm not happy with that. All right, let's go to number three on the list. Now, I reckon you'll remember this one, Finey. The year is 2002. The venue is the SCG. It's the Swans playing Port Adelaide. Port have got their noses in front. There's literally only a minute or so left on the clock. Let's see what unfolds.
Oh, Saddington, Hall. Can he put it through? Can he win the game? Big, bad Barry. Take a bow. You would think Port Adelaide would need the takeaway to win. Saddington, Hall, can he put it through? Can he win the game? Big, bad Barry, take a bow. You would think Port Adelaide would need the takeaway to win. The bounce. Primus, Sean Burgoyne. Four forth to Schofield, they get the takeaway. Poulton!
And the players around him say, hold it up. And we saw him in the second quarter kick a goal this end. He was about 20 metres out. Very unconvincing.
It has been an unbelievable season for shots after the siren. It has been...
And you feel for the kid. You really do.
A monumental season. For this kind of climax.
You'd love to be there, wouldn't you?
You'd love to. This is what you dream of.
Step up on the plate, Dermot.
Every kid in the backyard with the big trees lined up with the footy before Mum calls you in for dinner. The shot for goal after the siren to win it. Jared Poulton, your time has come. Drop part. Your time has come.
Good stuff. Pretty ice cool kick under pressure. He's one of those players that Port had who actually was quite serviceable for him, but you've sort of forgotten about him over time.
Me and my mates called Jared Poulton the third Corns because we thought he looked like one of the Corns brothers. And Kane actually kicked it to him.
Yeah.
He really did look like a Corns.
Yeah. And that was, remember, before they actually won the flag in 04, they just kept coming close, didn't they? In fact, they topped the ladder 3 years in a row.
Correct.
But, you know, in the end, it was a build-up to a pretty memorable occasion for that footy club. So, well done, Jared Poulton. You'll always have that one. Number two now. Now, North fans are going to love this one. The year is 1993. Dennis Pagan's taken over as coach. A young key forward called Wayne Carey is starting to take the game by the scruff of the neck. And this is probably the highlight of a season for them almost. So, playing Essendon, the Baby Bombers, who are on a big roll. There's a massive Friday night game, this one, and very, very tight at three-quarter time. Well, did the Roos steam home in the last quarter? An eight-goal final term with the King right on top of the throne. Let's have a look at the action.
I just get a feeling about North now, Bruce. Carried a long way.
50 again, as we know he is capable of. A long way from just inside the 50.
To put North in front. He's done it. The high flyers are there. Oh, Mark Longmire. He looks like he's going the banana kick. There it is. Oh, I think he's kicked it. Yes. North in front.
North Melbourne have come back quite magnificently. Schwatch's long one. Kira! Again.
Telling Mark.
Showing his championship quality.
Showing his class.
Yep.
A real match winner.
Kick from about 48 metres. Drop punt. That's better. We top tonight. Top of the table, the Kangaroos. As McAdam chips it away and puts it through.
Great stuff. They were just on fire. I should have said, actually, both John Longmire and Adrian McAdam, that short-lived comet, yep, on football's horizon, kicked six goals that night. Carey kicked four. It sort of came to a premature end almost that year for North. They ended up getting thumped by West Coast in the first final out at Waverley, but you knew that there was a pretty good side in the offing that night.
Timely, of course, because there's been detente in the premiership reunion problems that they had, so the King maybe has the crown back on top after problems in the throne room.
All right, well, let's go to number one. I don't think we're going to get a more, how should I put it, unorthodox number one in our rounds of our lives selections than this one. The year is 1999. The venue is Subiaco. The teams are Fremantle and St Kilda. We've just seen one Carey on fire taking some great marks. Well, here's another Carey taking a mark.
Distance, driving it around the outer side. Maybe had the line in mind. Didn't get the bounce he needed, though. Fletcher, a centering kick. And the mark has been taken by umpire Carey.
That is I've never seen that.
I have never, ever seen that.
He actually thought he was a player then. Yeah. There's no doubt about
that. He had a vision.
Carey by nature. Carey by nature.
It still makes you wet yourself, doesn't it? Has there been a weirder moment in an AFL football game?
If there has, it would only come in Freo St Kilda games.
That's true.
Siren Gate down in Tasmania.
That's true.
Whispers in the sky. And then when Ross Lyon went over there, created a new sort of level of friction between the clubs. There is, for some reason, two clubs that you wouldn't have thought had much to do with each other. A very strange history.
Yeah, and the only Carey to take a great mark and then get dropped for it. He actually got dropped for a week for that.
His excuse was the Edmund Hillary because it was there.
who among us wouldn't have done the same thing? All right, that's round to our lives for this week. Let's get to a break. We'll come back to answer your questions and perhaps a few of our own as well.
Nathan, I see you've brought your voting slip in. Is it vote one, Pauline Hanson, as usual?
Yeah, always.
Twitter was an exciting place over election weekend with some of the greatest meltdowns that cyberspace has seen. But it's still as exciting now as we take all your biggest questions, put our own spin on them, and somehow still produce an answer. It's time for Keyboard Q&A.
Not quite.
Okay, I know you like to interrupt, but just let the titles roll.
This is important.
What now?
Rohan, in the last few weeks, every important game that we've gone back and looked at,
yeah.
What three words do you say? I was...
Oh, there? Well, yeah. I've seen a lot of footy. Sorry.
I was on the ground. I was on the ground when that happened. Sorry. Well, it's true.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Your ability to be at the right place at the right time predates... It doesn't just predate your coverage of football. It actually predates you.
Actually, it's funny you mention that because apparently story insertion, I think it's known as in the trade. And apparently I've moved to outright third place in the off-the-bench third-person self-congratulator of the year award, which is no mean feat given that I'm competing against the likes of Mark Robinson and Chris Gale. So, yes, I've noted my capacity to sort of put myself at the centre of events, and I apologise. I can be a complete tosser.
Well, here we go. Don't blush, baby. Let's go back to 1955. Marilyn Monroe's first upskirt. Looked on and have a guess who was there.
Oh.
In the background?
In the background with the pork pie.
The old gumshoe. Rohan Connolly.
Well,
he was there.
Well, you know, Marilyn and I did date for a while back in the 50s.
So yeah.
Just shortly before Joe DiMaggio. But taught Joe all he knows.
I bet you did. It continues, of course. 1963, November 22nd, Dealey Plaza, Dallas, Texas. One of the most famous moments in history. Rohan Connolly, he was there.
Well, see, I don't know if people know this, but you know what's ironic about that? That JFK actually was in the car with Governor Connolly, who got shot.
Well, a free shot. A free shot at Rohan Connolly? Who wouldn't want that?
All right, okay, great gag. Is that it?
No, last year, July the 19th, it was J Bay, Eastern Cape, South Africa. Everybody thought it was just one surfer and one shark. But of course, Rohan Connolly, he was there. But that was actually less of a coincidence because being an investigative journalist, you were there at a conference with the other sharks and predators, weren't you?
Well, you know what they say about journos. All right, okay, let's get into your tweets now, better than those sort of... they were pretty funny, actually. Okay, read the name. Who's it from? Mark?
Mark Orsich.
Okay, he asks, is the honeymoon coming to an end for Brendan Bolton, given the performances of Carlton over the last month? No, I'd say an emphatic no. I still reckon they've made great progress. Look, I mean, they were within two goals of the Pies, so, you know, they almost got the win there, and I think the gains have been really significant. Both in not just performance, but the spirit around the club. There's some players clearly coming through now. They've recruited well. So, no for me.
You've answered your own question there, Mark. Not even the end of the season, and the bar has clearly been raised that you're disappointed in a pretty close tussle with Collingwood. This is a team that wasn't supposed to win a game. They've won six, and the fact that they've been able to lift the expectation during the season means Brendan Bolton is still a beauty.
Here, let's go. Tweet number two, and it is from...
Lawrence.
Lawrence, who asks, can the Bulldogs play three tall forwards, Stringer, Redpath and Boyd? If not, who are their best two tall forwards? Well, I would argue that Stringer isn't actually a tall forward. To me, he's more an in-betweener. And I think if Boyd comes into that side, it'll actually help him because it takes the key defensive focus away from him, and he'll probably get under the radar a bit. Well, it's funny to say about a guy like Stringer, but I think, you know, you've got to pour your energies into key forwards first and foremost, so that enables him to take a lesser opponent. So I think they can definitely all fit in that same side, and I think they'd be crazy. Brendan Bolton would be mad, Prenton and Bolton. Luke Beveridge would be mad not to give them all a go together.
Disagree. Not that they can't play with Stringer. There would be no use, and I reckon a cumbersome forward line in the offing, if Boyd and Redpath played in the same forward line. He's a big, tall, leading marking target is Redpath, which I'm pretty sure is what Tom Boyd is, and you don't need two of those. It would remind me of Vickery and Griffiths, which works, not.
Okay, last tweet for the day. Here it comes. It's from
the one-armed man.
Who has the superior long-term leadership group at present, the Liberal Party or the Brisbane Lions? Ooh, it's a close call.
I don't think you're in any position to talk about anything further right in politics than the Socialist Worker Party.
I think the Brisbane Lions leadership group certainly less divided. There's two fairly obvious factions going on at the other club, I think.
Then again, if Andrew Bolt is Lee Matthews and Turnbull is Justin Lepich, then I'd rather be Justin Lepich than Malcolm Turnbull. The person publicly opining about the leader.
Yeah, okay. I just never want to be connected with Andrew Bolt in any way, shape or form. All right, time for our final break. Stay with us, though, because the witching hour is nigh and we're here to cast a furious spell. Welcome back. Well, if you think politics makes people angry, it's got nothing on the fury unleashed by Finey and I when it comes to football. You want incandescent rage? Rage? Why can't I speak today? You want incandescent rage over a seemingly trivial issue? We're your guys. So harness that hatred, because it's time for the Footyology Rant Off! All right, I can't even speak today, so I'm just going to get you straight in.
How can you get rage wrong? It's in the name of your favourite group of all time.
Yeah, that's a good point, good point. 3, 2, 1, rant!
There's no question about it. Etihad Stadium is definitely one of the most difficult places in Melbourne to find. Remember the olden days when you enter the footy and there'd be an announcement, a ground announcement, that there was a lost child? Now there needs to be announcements about there being a lost ground. A couple of weeks ago, I went to Etihad, southern section of the ground. I arrived there. Where's it gone? Where's the ground? There was a block of flats, some apartments. It certainly wasn't like the olden days. For me, going to the football is built up by, in the distance, the shimmering lights, seeing the haze of smoke climbing above an oval, surrounded by grandstands with beautiful goalposts. You get to Etihad now, and it really looks like an apartment building. In fact, you've got to catch a lift to get in. I did so with a couple called the Weintraubs and asked them what floor Etihad was on. They told me, not the third, that's where their son-in-law and daughter lived. Nice couple, took me 5 attempts to get to Etihad Stadium, which eventually is hidden somewhere, I think, on the mezzanine. Football grounds, I like them the way they used to be, not the way they're becoming.
That's true. There's something intrinsically wrong with having to get a lift at a football venue, I think. Okay, count me in.
3, 2, 1.
Federal politics has got a lot to answer for, Finey. Here we are in the middle of an AFL season and Malcolm bloody Turnbull goes and calls an election. And not just on any weekend, but on a night when Carlton are playing Collingwood, for Christ's sake. Let's be honest, that was about the flattest game between the Blues and Pies we've ever seen. And if that wasn't bad enough, we had to cop Brian Taylor using more tortured analogies about swings and preferences than I've ever pulled in any of these scripts, except this one. Come on, BT, if you're going to go all comedy, well, intentional comedy, at least you could have done the analogy about members after an exciting passage of play. Actually, hang on, that's unfair. There wasn't an exciting passage of play. I thought the Pies and Blues looked distracted all night. That's because they were. Too busy checking their smartphones for updates on the Senate and waiting to see another deposed MP get thrown in that industrial crusher thing that Channel 9 were using. Playing AFL football is a complex task for young blokes. It's taken the Pies all year just learning how to hit a target in black and white. What should they be expected to do if the ALP and Liberal Party can't hit their targets either? But things really went downhill once the big scoreboard started posting the latest figures from Goldstein, Petrie and Higgins. Of course it was going to be confusing. You had two teams who suddenly thought they were playing against North Melbourne.
That was a great finish.
Yeah,
it's good. Goldstein, Petrie and Higgins.
Oh, no, it's amazing.
That is very good. Easy to vote this week. You've actually already voted. I was the sex party, and Rohan was any vote that you casted for the voluntary euthanasia party.
Very good. Get stuffed. That's it for this week. Thanks for joining us again. We're on every Tuesday at 12 p.m. on YouTube, 7:30 p.m. on Channel 31, and every Thursday at 9:30 p.m. on Foxtel's Aurora. Remember, folks, like Toto put it in everyone's favourite 80s sing-along, Africa, the wild dogs cry out in the night as they grow restless, longing for some solitary company. I know that I must do what's right, as sure as Kilimanjaro rises like Olympus in a show called Footyology. I just had to get that line in about Kilimanjaro and Olympus. See you next week. Step it.